Morning, friends. Glad to be with you today or wherever it is this week that you happen to be listening to this chapter of Followers of the Way. Followers of the Way have met for decades, literally at beginning in the fellowship hall at Palma Sierra Presbyterian Church, but now occurring virtually, reaching out to old audiences and new, and we're glad to have you here, whether this is a place where you find yourself on a regular weekly basis, or whether it's someplace that you find yourself today for the first time. We're glad that you're part of our gathering together. And I'm here today with the Reverends Kenny Hubbell and John Debevoise and Will Wellman. And today, as we gather together, we're going to look at some text from the book of Mark, from the fifth chapter. It's either two parables or two stories, or one story combined within another story as we gather together this day. It's the story of a woman with a hemorrhage and a story of the healing of a child, and or the, actually not just healing, resurrection of her from the dead. And as we gather together, we'll look at the stories and have the opportunity for conversations. We invite your input and your questions and your thoughts. And so we can be reached by sending an email to John Debevoise at john@palmacia.org, or by responding to or commenting in any of the virtual platforms where you may be viewing this day. And that will be received by us and shared with one another. And we appreciate your participation in that. As we gather together, we always begin with prayer. And I believe as we gather on this date that the opening prayer is going to be by John.
Thank you, Mike. I'm glad to be here with you all. I appreciate the chance to offer prayer. Let's pray together. Creator, as we record this Bible study, we do so on the longest day of the year. How good it is that we're able to gather around Scripture at the beginning of this week. We pray for your blessing as we talk together, as we overhear each other, as we lift up your word once again. May the discussion, the hearing of it, the work of your Spirit in our hearts and minds through it as we travel across this week, may it nurture faith and help us to serve you better. I pray for your presence, your shepherding presence with all who might listen in or share in this Bible study. And we lift up the private and personal prayers that each one of us brings to our gathering together and ask that you would help us to know that you hear them and that you are at work in our lives as well as the life of the community around us and the world that you have loved so much you have given us, Jesus Christ. It is in his name that we pray. Amen.
Amen. As I mentioned earlier, the text for today comes from the book of Mark from the fifth chapter. It's starting at verse 21. It's the story of two stories, actually, of a woman with a hemorrhage and Jairus's daughter. The third and fourth of four stories that are gathered together in this section of the Bible. The first is the story of Jesus calming the storm. The second was setting out of the demon from the man out of the tombs with the unclean spirit, essentially an exorcism, one of three or four that are reported in the Bible. And today we come to the third and fourth miracles that are joined together, which is the story of a woman with a hemorrhage that she 12 years, and the story of Jairus and his daughter. And I think that Ken has agreed to read.
I am happy to read. I thought it was going to be Will reading. Will, do you mind if I read, or do you want to read?
I can read.
That was just my error. Will agreed to read, and you agreed to close, Ken. My mistake.
Thanks.
So the reading, as Mike mentioned, is from the Gospel of Mark in the fifth chapter. When Jesus had crossed again in the boat to the other side, a great crowd gathered around him, and he was by the sea. And one of the leaders of the synagogue named Jairus came, and when he saw him, fell at his feet and begged him repeatedly, "My little daughter is at the point of death. come and lay your hands on her so that she may be made well and live. So he went with him, and a large crowd followed him and pressed in on him. Now there was a woman who had been suffering from hemorrhages for 12 years. She had endured much under many physicians and had spent all that she had had. And she was no better, but rather grew worse. She had heard about Jesus and came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak. For she said, "If I but touch his clothes, I will be made well." Immediately her hemorrhage stopped, and she felt in her body that she was healed of her disease. Immediately aware that power had gone forth from him, Jesus turned about in the crowd and said, "Who touched my clothes?" And his disciples said to him, "You see the crowd pressing in on you? How can you say who touched me?" He looked all around to see who had done it. But the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came in fear and trembling, fell down before him, and told him the whole truth. He said to her, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease." While he was still speaking, some people came from the leader's house to say, "Your daughter is dead. Why trouble the teacher any further?" But overhearing what they said, Jesus said to the leader of the synagogue, "Do not fear, only believe." He allowed no one to follow him except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. When they came to the house of the leader of the synagogue, he saw a commotion, people weeping and wailing loudly. When he had entered, he said to them, "Why do you make a commotion and weep? The child is not dead, but sleeping." And they laughed at him. Then he put them all outside and took the child's father and mother and those who were with him and went in where the child was. He took her by the hand and said to her, "Talitha, come," which means, "Little girl, get up." And immediately the girl got up and began to walk about. She was 12 years of age. At this, they were overcome with amazement. He strictly ordered them that no one should know this and told them to give her something to eat. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
I just want to say, as we begin looking at this text, one, it's long text, but it's long text that also has just a tremendous amount of issues, I guess, in it, or tremendous amount of things that I think we can talk about as we look at it. It's important to realize the context in which these four miracles that I mentioned earlier are occurring. And this is a place where we find Jesus essentially on the other side of the lake. And part of, I think, the significance of these stories and the context around these stories is that you have Jesus dealing with audiences, Jewish audiences and non-Jewish audiences. You have him dealing with, in terms of the two primary persons in this collection of stories, you have the little girl who has died. We have the woman with the hemorrhage. One being the little girl is the daughter of a church leader, a powerful person in the community, somebody of significance, and the woman with the hemorrhage finding herself at the other end of that, finding herself probably as an outcast in society. We have Jesus acting in ways that we, in the context of what's occurring in society, you have him having contact with the little girl who has died, the touching of a corpse, which would make him unclean, and the fact that the woman is suffering from hemorrhage, that she would, under the culture of the day, would also have been unclean, and dealing with her or touching her or being in contact with her shows Jesus being in contact with somebody who in the culture of the day would have been unclean. And so it's significant what he's doing. And we have other things that are lifted up. The girl's 12 years old and the lady's been suffering from hemorrhage for 12 years. And in the context of it, it seems like there's lots of issues. But one of the first questions I think we can look at is these two stories find themselves together, essentially wrapped around each other. And the question is, how many pericopes do we have here? How many different stories? Is it one story? Is it two stories, one wrapped around another? What do you all think about that and the significance of these two stories being presented together?
Mike, is it your understanding from the text here at the end of four, or Will and Ken, that Jesus got in the boat at the end of chapter four, the second half of chapter four, and crosses the lake to the other side. There he encounters the Gerasene demoniac. Now this text says, when verse 21, when Jesus had crossed again in the boat to the other side. Do you think that means he's gone back to the eastern, the Capernaum side of the lake? Or is this like a second trip to the western side?
I don't think it's absolutely clear, but in answer to your question, I read it thinking he's gone back, that he was on one side, he's gone to the other, and now he's returned to the side that he began from.
I would agree, just because there's the Gentile group before, and now he's with the leader of a synagogue. So I would assume he's kind of back on the, for lack of a better term, the Jewish side.
And the familiar side.
Yes, sir.
Me too, but I'm just, you know, checking my assumptions. And I'm with you, Mike. You said you like this text. I think this is an extraordinary text. I mean, it's to me as if each clause of this text, you know, could be mined or worked with for study. It's a powerful story in that it involves not one but two miracles, and it's interesting to me that the one is encased in the other. You know, why is it so important to Mark to remember it that way? Or is that so intrinsic in the event that happened that it's lodged in the memory? I mean, these two could be separated easily. They could be separated honestly by any narrator later, you know, in the telling of a story. And so I'm thinking that there's something about the linking of these two together that is intentional to what Mark is trying to communicate to us. And gee, there's a lot of moving back and forth across this lake here in, you know, from four to five kind of quickly. The last trip across the lake, you know, was very dramatic. This time, he just crossed in the boat to the other side. And I almost want, you know, Mark to say, but there was no storm this time, you know, or it went uneventfully, you know. It's just sort of, whoop, he's back over. I'm not really answering your questions, but I am unpacking the text for myself a bit.
I would add to what John's saying that this kind of technique of the two stories interconnected is common. It's something that Mark uses, and oftentimes he's using it around stories about women. The biblical scholars call it intercalation, is the technical term. I think of it as like a story sandwich. You've got one story that's kind of separated by another story. So what's going on here is you have the story of Jairus and his daughter, and in between that story, we get this story of the woman with the hemorrhage. So I mean, you can consider it one single story because it's essentially interconnected. I would just say that they're kind of two connected stories, and I think they're deeply, deeply connected. You could go and make a list of all the connections, similarities, parallels that are happening between this story. Just for example, the woman suffering from hemorrhages has suffered for 12 years. And the young girl, right at the end of this passage, there's this kind of parenthetical notification that she's 12 years old. And so obviously there's some kind of connection being made there. I could go on and on, but I guess I'm just trying to say that these stories are intentionally told together because there's some sort of connection to between them.
When I look at this passage, something I'm thinking through is Jairus comes and there seems to be a sense of urgency. His daughter is on her deathbed. And then this moment with the hemorrhaging woman seems to be a considerable pause. And I think that has a feature in this text that makes it important, where if I'm Jairus, if I'm that family system, my daughter's on the deathbed here, any sort of disruption, any sort of moment where we stop and talk to the crowd seems disruptive. And we know that when they arrive, they may have arrived just too late And so there seems to be at least kind of a building drama with this moment of it being embedded within the story of Jairus and his daughter. I don't know exactly what we might gain from that, but the sense of Jesus is not bothered. Jesus can pause. He can step into the conversation with the hemorrhaging woman and give the time. And maybe Jesus' foreknowledge is just not worried about whatever happens to Jairus' daughter because he has a sense of the greater powers at play here. But it just seemed to catch my attention that it would be an element of the stories when this hemorrhaging woman story is embedded in the larger Jairus story.
For me, it also seems that the two stories being presented together, where what seems to be the more urgent call to go to heal or go to provide healing for the girl who is at least near death as the story begins, and taking the time, stopping to deal with the hemorrhaging woman, at least in part in my reading, I think could be argued that it suggests that neither of the issues is larger than the other. And if we draw these two stories connected to faith of the woman and faith of the father of the little girl, it says something there. I'm not exactly sure what I'm supposed to draw from that, but I feel like part of the story for me is the connection of the two coming together, saying neither one is more important to Jesus. Jesus is dealing with both of the issues that are before him. But the significance of the 12 that you know Will raised, it has to be there for a reason. It's not happenstance that the parenthetical exists near the end of the verse that says she was 12 years of age. So I find myself believing that I'm supposed to understand something from that. I'm supposed to take some significance from that, but I'm not sure what it is that I'm supposed to carry away from the woman having suffered from the hemorrhage for 12 years and the little girl being 12 years of age. Do any of you all have thoughts on that?
I don't think I have any explicit, like, this is why it's included, as much as I think there's parallels being drawn between these two stories, as well as differences, right? And I think you're lifting that up when you said Jesus heals them both and there's not one that's more important, because Jairus is essentially from the elite of society and this woman would have been more on the fringes because, first of all, she's just a woman and that's how the society was structured in that day and age. And secondly, she is most likely considered impure for reasons around her bleeding. And we read about too that she's had issues with doctors and maybe financially as well. And so there's a juxtaposition between Jairus, who comes publicly and begs Jesus and bends down, and this woman who kind of just touches him secretly. And so I think the text is making, it's contrasting as well as comparing these two stories. And the I guess the thing I would say about the 12-year-old thing is this one woman is older and towards the end of her ability to bear children. And this younger woman is at the beginning of that stage. And so I think you're seeing Jesus healing someone that's coming towards the end of one phase and another that's coming to the beginning of that phase. And yet Jesus is bringing healing to both of these people. It's bringing life to both of those people. So I guess I just see all these swirling comparisons and contrasts, and I don't have like an answer I can get, just kind of tie up with a bow, as much as say that the text is pointing us to these things.
It does seem to me that, you know, they're both being 12 is a comparison that draws closer. And they were both, one suffered for 12 years and the other was 12 years old. You know, one had suffered as long as the other one had lived. And so, you know, there's 12 tribes of Israel and there's 12 apostles. But I don't think that there is intentional link with those numbers for any reason I can see. I can the 12 apostles with there being 12 tribes of Israel, but I don't see how that would reconcile with the number 12 here. I don't understand that the number 12 has the same power as the number 40 or the number 10 or the number 7 in terms of the use of numbers in scripture, or the number 3. All of those numbers seem, you know, more symbolic to me. It's interesting to me that it connects with the number of tribes, but I think that it's just a function of pointing out, as you said, Will, he's caring for these women, both children and old of age. Both of them could be vulnerable. Both of them probably were vulnerable. He is reaching out and healing, even to the point of restoring to life, both of them. Jesus cares about vulnerable people. Jesus cares about vulnerable women. And in the first one, the woman touches his garment. That's much is made of that. And he's aware that he's touched. In the second one, he takes her by the hand, verse 41. So he touches them both times. And that seems to me that Jesus not only cares about them, he's willing to reach out and touch them, even though that may risk making him ritualistically impure or, check his status in the community in some way. I'm thinking that that's a part of what's going on there too.
When John was speaking, I was reminded too, in verse 34, he calls this, at the very end of the kind of middle story, he calls the woman daughter. And that transitions right into the story of Jairus's daughter. And he's also mentioning her faith. And he speaks to Jairus and says, don't be afraid, only believe, in 36. And so you're having that daughter and faith connection as well. There's so much in this story. I mean, yeah. I feel like we could just go on and on just with the comparisons and contrast between them.
I think that's true. I think the end of the one story where we read, daughter, your faith has made you well, go in peace and healed, be healed of your disease. And while he was still speaking, some people came from the leader's house to say, your daughter is dead, wraps it directly together. And in terms of the use of the word. And I think it's significant that in Jesus speaking to the woman suffering from the hemorrhage is referring to her by the same kind of language as the little girl is being referred to, the same kind of care and compassion language, I think, is what's being lifted up. Let's talk a little bit about this, this Jesus feeling the touch of the woman suffering from the hemorrhage, who apparently is approaching him in a crowd. Even the disciples say, there's no big deal about being touched. But I don't think Jesus is talking about, like, if you're bumped in the crowd and you realize that somebody has touched you. I think he's talking about feeling the touch in the kind of way that he's feeling what I guess in my reading I would describe as a transfer of energy, what my friends who believe in Reiki would describe as the healing power of touch. Or what I've experienced as a chaplain when I was in seminary at the hospital and being in a room when someone is sick, and especially at the time of death, when I would describe for you the feelings that probably many of you have experienced too, of feeling energy change in the room, energy move in the room. And I think that's part of what Jesus is acknowledging in the story here, is the healing power coming from him to the woman with the hemorrhage. Am I reading too much into that?
No, I think that's there. No, I think that's what it's referencing, is his awareness of an energy. I don't think it's, I mean, the story's explicitly saying it wasn't just that he felt a physical touch. The disciples noted anybody could have touched you here in this crowd jostling around. There's some sort of energy that's referenced. And it's a different, isn't it? I wonder if there's any parallel for this in the scripture at all with respect to the life of Jesus. Do we find any other place where we have a reference where it feels like, energy is the focus of what's being told in terms of energy transmitted out of Jesus. It matches a little bit for me. I mean, there seems to be some match in the memory. There's the memory with respect to the healing of the woman, of the touch in which the miracle occurs. There's something in the touch that's the conduit for the miracle of healing there. At least that seems to be what he's acknowledging. Energy came from him. In the second story, there's something in the word. I mean, we're given the Aramaic phrase. I don't want to call it an incantation, but I'm trying to find another phrase, language. Why does Mark remember the Aramaic phrase here, and give that to us? We're not getting the rest of this in Aramaic, in terms of what he says. So why are we getting this? And in part, that's because I just think the community remembers, what did he say when he took her hand? Exactly what did he say? What did he say? Those specific words are very powerful. And I think if they are looking for the conduit by which the miracle occurs, the touch and the word seem to match, more so even than his taking her by the hand. But maybe it's, the touch of her hand.
Yeah, I think that's, like John's saying, that's definitely part of the story, and it's something we have to wrestle with, what's going on. I think it's interesting, too, that Jesus ascribes the healing to her faith. And so there's obviously something coming from touching Christ, but there's the counterpoint of Jesus saying to her, daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease. Which I like the complexity of. It's not either or, it's kind of both and. And like John's lifting up, is it the words that Jesus speaks? Are these some kind of incantation, or is there more to it beyond just the words? And it's probably both and.
And Jesus is speaking to the Father, says, do not fear, only believe. He's just been told that his daughter has died, which is what he's worried about as he's approached Jesus. And the crowd has just told him that they've confirmed his worth fears. And Jesus says back to him immediately, do not fear, only believe. Talking about believing and faithfulness again, it seems.
Another thing I just noticed, I hadn't noticed this when I was preparing earlier, is that Jairus falls down at Jesus's feet and begs him repeatedly. And then the story of the woman, after Jesus says who touches him, the woman falls in fear and trembling before Jesus. So there's another connection between these two stories. I feel like I'm just pointing out connections, but not drawing any conclusions here. Maybe we need Kenny to come in and clear everything up for us.
Well, before he does, Will, I want to say, the text is a part of what does that. It's like looking at a painting into which you keep seeing details the more you look at it, and you're convinced that these details are important in the painting because they're not simply bland details, but they're details that are rich. And so I do think that's a part of the work of encountering this text, is articulating the details that seem substantive in it. So I don't think that it's strange that we should be doing this. Now Kitty can come in and explain them all in some unified theory of meaning of the tales.
Sure, John. Happy to do that. Now, I think when you see these two stories next to each other, you can't help but make those comparisons because there's so many comparisons. But if these stories were three chapters apart, I think it would have the effect of reinforcing certain elements of who Jesus is. I know this passage comes into the kind of greater sense of Jesus's kingship. What does the person of Jesus in the ministry look like? And the elements that we're drawing connection to with Jairus and the woman falling down at their knees in the sense of their sovereignty here, Jesus's willingness to heal, how faithfulness leads to healing. I wonder if just it's more about the elements rather necessarily than the the shared elements that are existing in these two stories. If I'm reading Mark's gospel, if I'm experiencing alongside the people in Mark's gospel, I'm still kind of uncovering a sense of who Jesus is, and we're learning a lot about who Jesus is in these two stories. They're similar. We learn similar things about who Jesus is, but I keep falling back towards powerful, humble, willing to heal both the elite and the ostracized or on the fringe of society. Those elements seem like they stand alone, even if it was just one story or the other.
So are we supposed to just be carrying away the pieces, as Kenny says, of what's here? And there's lots of pieces. There's lots of little tidbits, lots of examples of who Jesus is, lots of demonstrations of who he is and what it was that he was teaching and how he acted. I find myself, you know, trying to think in my own mind, is this a story about healing? Is this a story about faith? Is this a story that I'm supposed to find some other message from? Is there significance in the difference between healing and essentially resurrecting the little girl who has died? But part of it, part of me wants to look at this and try to take it as sort of building blocks. It's like looking at a piece of art. I was at an art museum over the weekend and had the occasion to stand in front of a painting where I'm no art critic or art expert. I assure you I'm not. I sort of look at a painting and try to decide what it is that I see in it. But in the painting, I ended up observing some of the paint strokes that were in the drawing. And as it related to where the patterns of color were and the image that was in the painting, I began to believe that there was some significance to the strokes in the paint itself. I don't know if that's true or it wasn't, but in examining the picture, I found it that way. And part of me feels that way about this passage as I read it. Although there's lots of other elements that we've talked about already. One of the other big elements of that for me is the similarity between the story involving the little girl and the story of Lazarus and raising Lazarus from the dead, and the key significance to that in the story of Jesus's life, the pivot that occurs there as we move into Holy Week. What do we take from the relationship between the story of the little girl here and the story of Lazarus? Is there anything there, or is it just two stories of resurrection?
Those are like 40 questions you just laid on us, Mike.
I do. You know what to say? I do think it's fair to say the church makes central the resurrection of Jesus from the dead. But the amount of shock that we have about the resurrection of Jesus from the dead, it seems undermined by the experience of the gospel in reporting he's resurrecting people from the dead in numerous places, at least two, this girl and Lazarus in John's gospel. And so we should come to the death of Jesus with at least the understanding that for God, this is possible. Jesus has showed us that death is not an impossible boundary for God. And Mark shows it here, and John shows it in the story of Lazarus. I think it does serve then to push the power onto God. That is to say, it is God who resurrects Jesus. Here is Jesus who's resurrecting the little girl. I think the story is also tied with the one that just came. He's the Lord of creation. And now he's the Lord over demons, and now he's the Lord over, you know, even the boundary of death. I think they build in terms of their connectedness here. You're getting within the second half of 4 and the first half of chapter 5 here, 1, 2, 3, 4 miracles in a row, right? 4 healing miracles, except the creation one in the lake. Creation one in the lake, the exorcism, and then the two healings, one that Jesus is kind of unintentionally connected with, and the other that he's quite intentionally connected with. So it's a very powerful statement about who is this man, which is the question they ask at the end of the first miracle story. And in some ways, this may be the miracle, this may be the passage that is appropriate at the end of Mark's gospel. At the end of the eighth verse of chapter 16, we get the empty tomb in Mark, you know, but we don't get the account of the resurrected Jesus himself. But we do have these powerful stories, including his raising people from the dead. So it's wrong to say there isn't a resurrection in Mark. There is.
I think I would add to that, and to get back to your questions, I think John's right to tie this into what comes before. There's especially like last week's text is Jesus stilling the kind of cosmic forces of nature. And then the passage that's between that and today's passage, Jesus healing the Gerasene demoniac, is Jesus healing the kind of cosmic evil forces of a demon or a legion of demons. And so we're continuing along this storyline of Mark's gospel introducing who Christ is and essentially what Christ is. Christ is someone that has the power to steal not only nature, but kind of the spiritual forces of evil. And now we move towards this more personal story, but it's deeply powerful. There's healing, there's resurrection. And so it's like Mark is kind of hitting us over the head with narrative, drawing us into who Christ is. And I think there's one point in this passage that really sums that up for me, and that's verse 37. He allowed no one to follow him except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. Those are the three that are there at the Transfiguration. So it's like that might not ring bells if you're hearing this for the first time, but when you think about, you know, where in Mark's gospel is Mark really telling us who Christ is? Here's a very, it's a resurrection story. That's yes. Like John's lifting up. That's important. That rings bells. That same crowd, that very intimate group of disciples, not all of them, just these three, is the same that witnesses Christ transfigured, which is a huge kind of marker of who Christ is, and that Christ is different, and that Christ has a relationship with God, and that there's something beyond what we can even consider divine happening with the person of Christ. So I think all that to say that this passage is deeply telling us who Christ is, in addition to these elements of it doesn't matter your social background or your religious background, Christ is going to bring you healing. I think when you flip that and say, what is the message of this passage for us in the church? I think the question is, are we leaving people in a better place than when we met them? Because that happens with both of the encounters Christ has here. The older woman and the younger woman both leave in a better place through their encounter with Christ. And oftentimes, I think the church doesn't do that. Unfortunately, I think a lot of people have bad encounters with the church. And I think this is pushing us to kind of get rid of all of our baggage and say we need to meet people in a place where they're leaving that encounter better. I've talked for too long, but I'll add one other thing. I think this story is telling us that physical healing is intimately linked to our spiritual faith, and that it's not one or the other, but both. And
I agree with what Will's saying there. And the thing that becomes of greater interest to me is what happens next after this crescendo in these stories, building upon each other, pointing out the things that Will just pointed out. What happens next in the narrative, at least here within the Gospel of Mark, is Jesus returns to his hometown where he's essentially rejected for who he is. And so while we have these stories building on each other, and people beginning to realize who Jesus is and witnessing it, when he returns to his hometown, to his family, to the people who would have known him the best, he's rejected to the point that he gives up and leaves town again and goes back out to go to work. What do I make of that?
I think it's a word to the church, you know, that you should expect that Jesus and you as representatives of Jesus will be rejected. You will not experience as the norm acceptance and celebration. Even in the face of miraculous things, you will still be rejected. And do not be afraid, and don't be surprised. Or if you are surprised, get over it, because this is a part of the way the world reacts to the good news of who God is.
John?
Yeah.
Oh, I was going to ask you, do you think it could also speak to the church as us being the ones that reject Jesus sometimes? I mean, this is his hometown, right?
Yeah.
And so I wonder too, like, I get what you're saying, and I think that's definitely part of it, but I wonder what you think about this being a message to the church. To Jesus is dealing with things that are against the kind of purity laws of that day and age, dealing with a woman that would have been on the fringe of society, doing healings like resurrecting someone that would have been considered witchcraft or something to that effect, you know? And so I wonder if it's flipped on us as we need to be more open to the work Christ is doing around us.
That's helpful for me, Will. Yeah, it may be more a word to the church about their own unaware rejection of Jesus and need to be open in the pattern in which he was open.
I know this is a rich text with, as we've said already, many, many things that we can discuss in great detail, but as we often do at the end of our times together, I wanted to ask, what is it that we're supposed to carry away from this text? What is it that we put in our pocket and have for ourselves, or more importantly, what is it we take from this text and carry out into the world and share with others or share with the world?
I think I'd go with Mike. This text speaks to me powerfully when Jesus says in verse 1 where he says, "Do not be afraid." The text 30, says
36.
Yeah, 36, do not fear. Because that matches, you know, the word from Jesus in the midst of the storm as he comes across the lake for the first time. Don't be afraid. And here it is, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid of things that you may, the power you find in creation. Don't be afraid of death. Don't be afraid of illness. Don't be afraid. That's what I, you know, find it touching my heart with. Don't be afraid.
And with that, I keep coming back to the hemorrhaging woman and that sort of boldness, the courageousness that she has to even act in her faithfulness. I'm still kind of mulling over what the implication is there, but I like the initiative she's taking. I like the trust that she's showing. I like that kind of, even that desperate plea for transformation and healing. I just think there's something, really exemplary in that. And I kind of want to continue thinking about that.
I think both of those are great points. I would just add what I said earlier is that one thing I'll kind of take to heart with this passage is, you know, what is happening in my encounters with other people? And how is this story pushing me to make those encounters more transformative in a positive way, and to affect healing in whatever way that looks like? I also just want to lift up, like, this is such a gorgeous, beautiful story. And I think our familiarity sometimes kind of brings one of these stories to kind of like a superficial level, they just become part of our memory and we just think they're that way. But talking with y'all about it today is just reminding me how rich of a text this is. And I mean, you could preach or do a class on this text for months. There's just so much in there. And so it's just been a joy. It's always a joy to study with y'all, but this text is just great.
I agree with John, and would have, you know, if I'd gone first, I would have said that the text that I'm drawn to is "Do not fear," and the second part of that also, "Only believe." And both parts of that is important. The message of "Do not fear," but "Only believe," and those two things go together. More so for me over the last year of dealing with the pandemic, dealing with what we're dealing with in the world, dealing with the world of politics, dealing with systemic racism, I find myself wanted to be overwhelmed sometimes and wanting to be fearful in the world, but the message is do not fear, but only believe. But that's wrapped around or in the context for me too, that as Jesus enters the room where the little girl is, he says to them, "Why do you make a commotion and weep? This child is not dead, but sleeping." And the next words are, "And they laughed at him." That's what we're told in this text, is how the crowd is responding to Jesus, who has just performed the miracle that he's performed with regards to the hemorrhaging woman. And he's come to this house dealing with the reality of the faithfulness of her father. And he's come there to deal with her, and they laughed at him. And he puts him outside, and he stays inside with the parents, and there's the resurrection. So it's those two things together for me in this text that we're being told to do not fear and only believe. And for me, that's as important language. It's as important to me at 69 years of age and the year 2021 as it may have ever been at any time in the past for me. And that's what I think I see in this text. But it's in the context that sometimes even if I want to believe that strongly, if I want to have that kind of faith, sometimes the world's going to laugh at me. Mm-hmm. And that's just a reality that we all have to be willing to live with. That's just part of what I think the text is also trying to say. Mm-hmm. Other thoughts? See, let me look at my notes here. So I try to get it right this time. I think that Kenny is going to close us with prayer. Is that right, Kenny?
That's right. Let's pray. Gracious God, we give you thanks for the stories we find in your scripture. We give you thanks for the model of healing and faithfulness in the story today. We ask that you help us get over our fear, that we might not hesitate, but move towards things that are healing and full of your love and grace to those we encounter. Lord, we ask that you be with us in our thinking through what this means for us, how we interact with this story, even as we find ourselves removed from this story thousands of years later. Help us be empathetic to those who are hurting. Help us have a sense of what justice and peace looks like for those who are on the fringes. Lord, help us just really follow your footsteps in towards your grace and the kingdom that you have coming towards us. We pray all these things in the hope of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray together, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen."
Amen. Followers, I'm glad to have been with you. Each of us are glad to be with you this day as we have the opportunity to join together in fellowship and the studying of some very powerful scripture with lots to carry forward in the week ahead. We give thanks for that. I especially give thanks for the chance to be with my friends and colleagues as we've had the discussion, but I'm certainly grateful for the chance to be with you virtually as we have had the opportunity to examine what we've examined this week. I want to remind you that we love to hear comments from you, and so I solicit input from you, thoughts that you may have or suggestions that you may have. And as we gather together and finish up our time together, I give thanks for that. I also lift up prayer. prayers for others who may be on your individual hearts and minds, people that you know this day have special needs, and we pray for them and pray for healing in the world. And we especially hope this day that we each go from this place not fearing, but only believing. Look forward to being with you again soon. Bye-bye from Tampa.